And welcome everybody to yet another wonderful session at the University of the Underground as part of the program New Politics and Afrofuturisms, and which is basically calling for Black radical imagination and pop culture as possible vehicles for propelling progressive social justice narratives to mainstream audiences, with a specific focus on Afrofuturisms, activism, climate justice, and the arts and politics as well. So for those of you not familiar with the University of the Underground, it is a free, pluralistic, and transnational university based in the basement of nightclubs with its headquarters in Amsterdam. But as you can tell, due to recent global events, it is based online. So the title of this wonderful lecture that we've got today is titled Circus and New Politics. And our wonderful, wonderful guest lecturer for today, his name is Paula Chaves Bonilla. Paula is a Colombian non-binary lesbian. She's worked as a director, choreographer, performer, teacher, and activist, and is based in Amsterdam. And she's born and raised within the boom of narco-paramilitarism and the expansion of neoliberal politics. She conceives art as a survival strategy and a device able to hack the hegemonic power structures at play. She studied dance and circus in New York, Bogota and Berlin, and later obtained a bachelor's degree in choreography at the School of New Dance Development in Amsterdam University of the Arts. And coming from a legacy of political dissident rooted in her family history, Chaves Bonilla works as a migrant refugee and queer activist. Between 2012 and 2016, she has worked as co-organizer of Queeristan, a DIY festival in Amsterdam to explore and counter the normative workings of gender, sexuality, and identity. And is also a co-founder of Queer Latinx, a platform to support trans and queer Latinx migrants, refugees, and feminist Latinx artists. And this is just a very, very, very brief introduction to Paula. Paula is someone with lots of skills and abilities, and honestly, we are truly, truly honored to have you here today, Paula, and for you to share your wisdom and your thoughts, and we're just grateful for you to take the time out. And I will give the floor over to you, and just want to say welcome, and thank you very much. Right, I'm gonna hand over to Paula. Over to you, Paula.
Maggie, thank you very much for the extensive introduction. It's also a pleasure to be with you. I'm like a very fan of the initiative that you have with the University of the Underground, very badass project. Thanks, Nelly, also for inviting me. I first just wanna tell you that I hope I'm not having problems with my connection. If I do, maybe I suggest that you use the chat so that not to overload, and then I know that I would have to wait. What else? Yes, we started a little bit late, Magic. Is it possible to go 10 minutes over the time that we planned?
Yeah.
Great. All right, let's start. So today I'm gonna be making a link between like circus, the legacies of circus, going into post-circus and new politics. I'm gonna first start by sharing a screen, a little excerpt of the film Freaks, which is a film done in 1932. It's a US-American pre-coded horror film produced and directed by Todd Browning. And starring Wallace Ford, Leila Hyman's, Olga Plakhanova, and Ross Q. Attes. It follows a trapeze artist who joins a group of carnival sideshow performers with a plan to seduce and murder a dwarf in the troupe to gain his inheritance. But her plot proves to have dangerous consequences. This is a very special film because it was filmed, sort of like at the beginning of the 20th century. It was with real actors. It's a beautifully, like the cinematography is really beautiful film. It was a film that when it was released, it was banned because it was considered too obscene. So it was just until the 60s, like almost 30 years later, that the film could actually be screened in the Venice Film Festival first. All right, so here we go. Desktop. Maybe to move from here. Advertising what? Warner. Not the intention, of course. So, so like many film scholars have, like, this is a really special film because of what I was telling you before, and also because in relation to the portrayal of Greeks, many filmmakers like talk about that this film is actually talking about class conflict, because of its timing, it's talking about the Great Depression. And many filmmakers actually said that is one of the films that actually promotes anti-eugenics politics, and where freak, like people that were labeled as freak, are portrayed in the in less violent ways. And I'm gonna be sharing some. So this is also a poster of the Freak Show. There is here other characters that were used. I really like the aesthetics of the posters. So they were all like, right, like Selah's wonders and things out of the world. Something that like either the beard woman, the small man, the giant person, the savages, the Freak Show. All right, so we're gonna enter into the first, to go into like what is the legacy of the Freak Show. Okay, so yeah, I'm gonna start by talking. Let me come here. Basically, there's a really interesting text that talks about the story of the freak show from Elie Claire, who is a disabled intellectual academic. And she basically starts analyzing, okay, where does this, where does the word comes? Why do I associate or not associate with this word? And of course, making a connection with all abnormalities that are in our society. Yeah? So like she's talking about, for example, the retard or the cripple, that is like kind of words that you would use for people with disabilities. And then like following that, linealogy, she goes into like, okay, what is freaks, yeah? So the freak show started in the, it extends back to Western civilization. It starts around the 1800s, 1900s in the United States, basically. And it was a place like sort of like a showman place where people that were what we now call disabled, people that were like not normative, either cognitively or physically, people that were not white, right? Any type of racialization, people that were not heteronormative and gender cis, they were rendered as abnormals, huh? And they were portrayed as something that is out of this world. So Ellie Claire in this chapter that's called Queers and Freaks says they came to have their ideals of normal and abnormal, superior and inferior, their sense of self confirmed, strengthened. So she's talking about the audience and why the audience loved the freak show so much. They were not staring at freaks of nature. Rather, the freak show tells the story of an elaborate and calculated social construction that utilized performance and fabrications as well as deeply cultural beliefs. So the cultural beliefs of the Western society. Differences among various groups of people who work as freak remain important to understanding the freak show in its entirety. But whatever the differences, all four groups held one thing in common. Nature did not make them into freaks. So Ellie Claire is talking about these four groups, and basically she talks about the first group is disabled, both white people and people of color, that are sold like as armless wonders, frogmen, giants, midgets, camel girls, wild mind of Borneo. The second category is non-disabled people of color. So they're the people that were basically brought from, right? Enslaved people that were brought to the United States. And then they would represent the cannibals or the savages within the freak show ideals. Then there is a third group that is the non-disabled people of color from the United States, so like the natives, basically. And then the fourth group is non-disabled people with visibly differences, so like a fat woman, a beard woman, a thin man, a giant man. And then Ellie says something important, because she says that that the differences among these groups are actually important. That is important for us to understand what these differences are between the four groups that like constitute the freak show in its entirety. But of course, like one thing that that all groups like have in common is that nature did not make them into freaks. Huh? So they were made freaks, socially constructed for the purpose of entertainment and profit. Then we start like going into the economy of profit and art, yeah. Any estimation of exploitation in the freak show needs to also include Halls and his troupe of human oddities colluding together to exploit the rope. So this is an interesting point, because basically Hall was a person that had a freak show. He was a showman and had many freaks inside his show, and Then there was Robert Borgan, that was an academic and wanted to study what freaks are. And then Hall sends a letter to Borgan in this exchange, and he says, "I exhibited freaks and exploited them for years. Now you're going to exploit them. The difference between authors and the news media and the freak show operator is that we pay them." So yeah, this is a very actually interesting argument, because of course, like in the text that here Ellie talks about, basically Hall is using the word exploitation as like not in a serious connotation, sort of like a joke. And when he basically wants to stay here, is also that is an interesting point that both the freaks and the showman exploited the herd. So they were actually benefiting and exploiting for the ignorance and the exotization and the fear that white US American people had of otherness in order to benefit and have a job and make profit, basically. And then he goes further into he's making this link because, yeah, maybe I go next year. So unsurprisingly, normality was defined exclusively in terms of whiteness and able-bodiedness. For the century in which the freak show flourished, disability was not yet intrinsically linked to pathology. And without pathology, pity and tragedy did not shadow disability to the same extent as today. So why is Claire making this link of like, okay, whether well, just like putting this, bringing this reflection into the question of whether how was exploiting them or not. And he then says in a system where like the showman is also like your legal guardian, of course you are exploited. But what is interesting is that the freaks had a job. And many actually of them, like he also talks about that some freaks that were not cognitively impaired were also kind of the authors of their own show. So they were also kind of being responsible of the narratives that portrayed them and even selling and making the business and making tours for themselves. Later on, when the pathologization of disabled bodies begins, then the, let me see. Yeah, so he says during the freak show, every heyday to the dominant model of disability, the medical model did not yet exist. This model, so the medical model that we have now, defines disability as a personal problem curable and or treatable by the medical establishment, which is in turn has led to the wholesale medicalization of disabled people. So basically disabled people are moved to a place of, he's talking about, of pity, of shame, and they lose their jobs. So he makes kind of like this reflection, also talking about like contemporary culture in where many disabled people are basically pushed into being jobless and therefore ostracized from society, while in the time of the freak show, they were able to work. And then he like follows out on a research that he does on on a person that was a freak. It's called the Gentleman Giants, Waldorf. And he writes later an autobiography. He was like working in freak shows first, and then when the medicalization of not true. He was working as a freak, as in the freak shows, and simultaneously there was a scientist who wanted to study him because he was really tall. And the scientist said, "You're probably the tallest man on the world." And then he says, he explains that Robert was far, like in the biography, The Gentleman Giant, it's revealed that Robert was far more disturbed and angered by his dealings with doctors than with showmen. And maybe I just want to bring, so this is the, yeah, and the last one, the couple in the cage easily replicate the relationship between Rob and Frick, suggesting that the old images of race, rather than being dead, live painfully close to the surface. So the couple in the cage is this performance by Gomez Peña and Coco Fusco. I also send you a link to the performance, the performance they did in 1994. In which they reenacted and being the name of an island and basically tour around kind of and the price that the people actually a lot of people believe savages and they didn't understand the part that they were making as
I think we've got a technical problem, guys. Oh, hello. You're on mute, Paula.
Mute.
Yes.
Are you listening to me well, Majid?
I can hear you now. Sorry, what was that?
Yeah, so, all right. So I'm going to keep on going then. I'm hearable. Yeah, I just wanted to bring that it's interesting the reflection that Claire does on how the system exploits actually oppression, and it's also interesting to think. I'm also bringing this because it's also interesting to think about that right now, like how also the system, the art market, academia is also exploiting oppression, the capitalization of poverty. And of course, also the question of who is the author of such narratives. Do we actually, as people of color, as people that are queer, have the narratives to portray ourselves as we want in academia and art? Are we following trends because we also need to survive? So it's quite an interesting question. All right. I'm gonna move on, and I'm gonna be talking basically now, moving to contemporary and basically speak about the role that Circus has had in Latin America, in South America in particular, in regard like to social movements. And later on, I'm gonna go deeper into how the Circus and contemporary definitions of Circus through cabaret, queer feminist cabaret, are also reclaiming the art form of Circus in a new light. But first, to enter into into how Circus has been actually a social project, I'm gonna introduce you to Circo para Todos. This is a school that is in Cali, Colombia. It's a school that was made as a social project in Aguas Blancas, which is a very poor, like old Islam neighborhood in Cali. A lot of Afro-descendant people live in this region. And they did it as a social project to basically give opportunity to kids to have another life. I think I'm sharing a screen still, right? Yeah. All right, so we go with Circo para Todos.
Your screen's not shared.
Yeah, we cannot see. Screen.
Mm-hmm. So please be a little bit patient. Thanks for the, okay. Share a screen. All right, can you see my screen now?
Yeah, I can see it now, thank you.
Mis amigos, yo estaba en un grupito que se llama Los Bombásticos, que son peladitos que para vos estar con ellos tienes que probar, y probar es como pelear con alguien para pertenecer a ese grupo y que nadie se meta con vos, ni nada, como una banda. Y yo estaba en ese cuento. Bueno, estaba empezando y ya estaba con ellos y todo eso. Entonces, y casi todos están muertos, todos. Yo le doy gracias a Dios y a mi abuelo, que igual también que influyó mucho para yo estar en la fundación, que me cambiaron el rumbo.
Working a lot with the actual institutions that took the children were placed there for protection. So either they'd been taken off the streets or they'd been taken away from families because of difficult things in the families. We founded it in Cali in 1995. The idea was we started like in 1997, 4-year course, so that they leave with a diploma in the hand and a career in front of them.
La Fundación Circo para Todo hacen unos talleres en casas de bajos recursos. Empiezan con unos talleres que son como 6 meses, y ahí lo cogen a uno y hacen unas evaluaciones para entrar a la sede. Entonces, lo que pasa después de los seis meses es que lo llevan a uno a la escuela y uno empieza a estudiar. Son 2 años que se aprende todas las técnicas de la fundación, todo lo que se llame circo, todo lo que incluye al circo. Los otros 2 años son de preparación de su número. El número en sí que uno dice, este es el que más me gusta. Yo describiría la vida del circo como una oportunidad para las personas que de pronto no saben qué hacer en la vida, ¿entiendes? Entonces, ¿qué es lo que yo veo? Que si, por ejemplo, mi vida, si no hubiera sido por el circo, yo no estaría en este planeta. Yo de pronto estaría en otra circunstancia. No creo llegar a conocer todo lo que conozco. Pero para mí es una forma de vida que es la más linda.
Circus is an art of perfection.
All right, I'm going to show you until this expert for now. What else maybe can I say of this? So parallelly, basically, while this kind of social projects start happening in different parts of South America. In Colombia, there is like 2 schools, one in Bogota and this one that is in Cali. There was also like a street culture growing on circles. So a lot of people basically went to the street, and the street, the place that is like normally used to, especially in the context of Colombia, like of narcotraffic, where people is like, that's related to drugs, but drugs in the sense of violence and gangs and becoming a sicario or a narco. It becomes a way of politicizing and taking over the public space. And this has been like something that happened in like the whole South America, where people travel among different countries and like take over the streets, where they're like teaching to each other different practices and also performing in the street. So like also having kind of like an independent way of living by like performing either in squares or in lights if you juggle. And I'm gonna now enter into the contemporary representations or the, I'm gonna go into dragging, but the display, like the contemporary updates of circus through the work of first La Chica Boom, which is also a text that I send you. Let me see. Yeah. So La Chica Boom is a Chicana artist, queer artist that is based in the States, first in California, and then she moved to Seattle. She's very important for Chicano Latinx performance, political performance, also part of La Pocha Nostra, which is an important collective. And she uses sort of neo-burlesque and parody in her performances. Ibarra's artistic practice hyperbolize modes of racialization that problematize and test the borders inscribed in her own body and coloniality, compulsory whiteness, heteronormativity, and Mexicanidad. So in this text that we read about the dominatrix of the barrio, it's very interesting how she's talking about the exploitation of identities. So she can be Mexican, but then she's also queer, but then she's also Mexican, because being Latina and Mexican is something different, of course, through the imperialist lens of the United States. It is not, but it is. And in this particular, one of the practices that La Chica Boom did in San Francisco after all the gentrification was basically travel with a bunch of queers doing a cabaret in the places that were before, where the queer movement started and that were now being gentrified. And while she was doing and the other people was doing performances, images of the people that was before part of that space were projected in the space. There was sort of taking over the space by writing in the walls, kissing the walls, leaving kind of wedges, marks on the space that they have been there. And this sort of ritual is what in this text she describes as the use of queer temporality, which challenges chromonormativity, where our notions of life within time have been dictated into a specific pattern or trajectory that serves the interest of heteronormative power structures. So the sort of leather metaphor. A key component of neo-burlesque subversive potential lies on the presence of irony and the performance direct address of the audience with a wink, a nudge, and a knowing smile. And this is a very important component of neo-burlesque, also of post-circus and also of post-theater. I like post-dramatic theater, talks about this break of the fourth wall where the performer is not just being watched as the freak before, but I'm also watching and gazing you back. So I have, then it comes the question of who is watching who, that gives an agency and element of self-authorship into the imagery that is being created and portrayed. Writing about two undiscovered Amerindians, so that's the performance done by Gomez Peña and Coco Fusco. Coco Fusco states that when viewers are faced with unexpected encounters and forced to undergo their own process of reflection, their defense mechanisms are less likely to operate with their normal efficiency. Caught off guard, their beliefs are more likely to rise to the surface. And this is also, of course, another, she's talking about not doing things that are unexpected or not following the expectations of what a show is. So this is where things, the divergence comes of what is circus as something that is servile to the system and post-circus as something that is, a social critique, actually, and a reclaiming of one's own livelihood. Performances to undiscover Amerindians, visit, and dominatrix of the barrio reveal the inclinations of viewers, spectators, and people in general to think of identity as visually apparent and identifiable. So this is very interesting because basically La Chica Boom calls herself an ethnic drag, and she's really busy with actually questions about Mexicanidad, but because people don't know these codes about Mexicanidad, they cannot read the complexity bringing into the performance, huh? Like she's being read as a Latina or as a Mexican within a US-centric gaze, but not particularly with the nuances. So she's talking right now here about how homogenization and this idea, this racism, heteronormativity, ableism projects in, right, like creates this idea of homogenization that is actually very violent. The constant concern about our realness reveal a need for reassurance that a true primitive did exist and that she, he be visually identifiable. So this is very interesting because then like Coco is also talking about here about how ridiculous is this idea of like whether it's true. I mean, like, of course they were not true. It was like in 1994 that like the two were like going up, like, this is ridiculous, but they still be right. So it's kind of revealing the absurdity of all these systems that are behind at place, huh? That are part of a capitalist and an imperialist system. So this need to hierarchize, huh? Okay, and I'm gonna go now to Nadia Granados. So basically it was also now talking about imperialism and capitalism, but imperialism, I'm gonna go a little bit here because it's a bit difficult. It's very difficult for like, I'm an artist, for a Colombian third world artist to find references of dissident disobedient performance lineages, because it is not that it is not there, but it is not recorded. It is not written in English. There is also not the means to create such an institution that actually can host also kind of the trajectory of artists that are like building on social critique, right? Because we are talking about spaces where there are censorship, spaces where there is no freedom of speech, spaces where such initiatives are not by any means being supported by any type of institution financially and also even persecuted. But I'm gonna now introduce you to Nadia Granado. She's a Colombian performance artist. She works also through like cabaret, no burlesque, a lot of parody. She's an amazing artist, and she talks about like in her work there is a lot an address about the politics of locality. So she's not talking about this idea of Latina, which is also very US centric, huh? But she's talking about Colombia and the specificities of Colombia being a place that has been in civil war for over 60 years, being a place where like we have all the war on drugs, all the narco violence, and wanting to basically use like here art becomes a platform where protests can be done. So in a country like Colombia, where like the mainstream channels of communication are owned by the same politicians, art and performance become a place where you can exercise freedom of speech, like create alternative modes of communication. And I'm gonna show you, this is in her Insta, because I couldn't find the... could I ask, am I still sharing a screen?
Yes. Yes, okay. you're still shared, yeah.
Es la cuestión, filosofía de la vida mía, es mi profesión, obediencia y balas, más que una ficción, el que más es mi religión, superestrella, película de acción, magia carburante de la destrucción, adrenalina pura como una erección, es mi vida, es mi parche, es mi convicción. Hoy
Importante es que los penes puedan seguir erectos, papi.
Plata flojo, esa es la cuestión, filosofía de la vida mía.
And this is actually a great link because something that Nadia Granados is doing, which is also very present in the performances of Vaginal Davies. Let me see, I have here, yeah. Yeah, so something that is very like interesting in what Nadia Granados is doing is, as you see, she's embodying kind of the figure that we feared. So it's the person, the matón, the asesino, the person that would come, the sicario, that would come and threaten you, kill your family, yeah? And then by embodying it, it's laughing, mocking back at it, at a figure that creates a lot of fear within a context of repression. And it's similar to what Vaginal Davies is doing in this text that I send you as well, the Why to be Angry, in which she imitates and becomes the object of desire. Yeah? There is this two, the parodic performance works on Freudian distinctions between desire and identification, to be or not to have, binaries, queer and disrupted. So I'm going to explain a little bit through the lens of this text of the Why to be Angry, how Vaginal Davies make this displacement and provincialize, decentralize, hack whiteness, the militia men. And also actualizing the art form of cabaret, yeah? And of cabaret and embodiment of otherness, because she's not busy with whether it's real or not. So the performances are produced and rooted within a deep critique of universalism. So Vaginal Davies is understood as a terrorist drag. Terrorist insofar as she's performing the nation's internal terrors around race, gender, and sexuality. When she's embodying like a militia man, also putting white face, but I'm gonna show you a picture how she does white face because she doesn't even want to be white, like she doesn't even try. So she basically just wants to show how absurd is the construction of that identity. Realness is neither achieved nor is it the actual goal of such project. A figure that is potentially threatening to people of color is revealed as a joke. The performances that are produced are rooted within a deep critique of universalism and dominant power bloc. Her blackness and queerness render her a freak among freaks. Rather than be alienated by her freakiness, she exploits its energies and its potential to enact cultural critique. Yeah, so I wanna sort of like wrap up a little bit there is a circle that I'm drawing right now here, because right now you can see how actually the circus is used as to reclaim power, and the gaze is completely and nonchalantly put back into the audience and into the ignorance of a system that is oppressive, that is racist, that is capitalist, imperialist, ableist. And she's mocking it. So it's a... It's dismantling the system because it's dismantling the fear that she has internalized within herself by performing such a thing, but it's also a protest in itself because it's also in the social tissue, is breaking, is crossing the fear that this creates among people of color, like the militiamen, for example. I'm going to show you some pictures of Vaginal Davies. And here are some others of La Chica Boom. So this is a performance of La Chica Boom performing Mexicanidad. This is the one that of the dominatrix of the barrio where she's dominating as a donkey, a donkey that is dressed up as zebra. This is Vaginal Davis. It's not so clear, but you can see Vaginal Davis in like not wanting to be like in white face, but not wanting to pass at all as a white person, clearly. And another one here of Vaginal Davis, which is a little bit small. All right, and I'm gonna close with with a last reflection that talks about, this is also going back to my research and kind of rooting from the question of why do I don't have any reference from like South America, Colombia? Why are we not referencing in the art world? And I'm talking about Latin America, but of course I also talk about Africa, I talk about in general the South Love, like where are our artists, where are our representations? Is it because we're like not smart enough? Like what is that happening there? And then what is revealed basically is the economical system that is behind the art market and how actually the art has been a welfare tool to further political discourses. And in that sense, how that has been, how the West and the First World Nations have sponsored their own art to also promote nationalism, to promote freedom, and to create imperialism. And how this intertwined with the art market and how it operates. So it's about art washing. Okay, so art washing. For that institutions and art practitioners, this means to examine and beware of the ways in which our modes of production are serving capitalism, profit-making logics, our cultural hegemonization, imperialism, and work to both dismantle them and transform them. Responding to these planetary issues from contemporary art practices, social movements, and activist initiatives requires that we are aware of the ways in which our struggles and technologies are being detached from its context of origin, like the digital sphere, rendered politically neutral and appropriated by capitalist humanitarian washing techniques like greenwashing, blackwashing, artwashing, and pinkwashing. All these capitalist cleansing technologies in which climate justice, black liberation, art practices, and LGBTQIA plus rights are appropriated by spin marketing techniques to clean and redeem the public image of countries, institutions, companies, or public figures that have engaged in unethical practices and a structural violation of human rights. We must learn from the historical entanglement between art and capitalist politics and recognize how art has been instrumentalized as a welfare tool to deceitfully but successfully help spread the belief that democracy and freedom equals capitalist consumption. And I just want to add something here, like there is this whole idea in the, I'm not an academic, so I cannot speak for academia, but at least in the art scene that there is no censorship here, that we are free and that whoever, you can do whatever, and then whoever can do their own work and whatever they want to say. But in reality, there is censorship because there is artistic proposals that are bringing institutional critique or critique against imperialism, racism, and are not being booked as much as art initiatives that are actually feeding into the capitalist system. The artisan cultural organization institutions of the Global South that are in constant fight to stay afloat, while cultural and art institutions in the North have the biggest art subsidies in the world and the stability that comes with such structural support. All of this wealthiness at the expense of the dispossession of our lands, the narco-war violence, and the genocide of the Southern Globe, working class, racialized populations. I could say more of this. This is a big topic, but I'm gonna leave it until here. Have some questions some time for questions. Anything that was not clear that you wanna know more? Also kind of.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Sorry, I don't want to interrupt. And is it possible to take some questions, or have you not finished yet? Sorry.
I'm done, Majid. Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Honestly, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for that very insightful, thought-provoking session. Generally, really appreciate it. I'm just going to open up to the students to and ask some questions. If anyone's got any, let me just stop. Yeah, that's better. Great. Guys, don't be shy. Does anyone ask any questions at all, please? And feel free to take yourself off mute and ask a question. If it's convenient, you can put your question in the chat box. While people are thinking, just a quick question, I'm just interested in. So I guess what inspired you to work or just to kind of engage in the circus? Like, what was the original impetus that kind of really propelled you to be like, I want to investigate, I want to do some work with the circus?
So Colombia is a very classist society. And that means that if you are from my parents comes from more like working class, like build themselves up. And I grew up in a middle class environment. And that means that all the people and all the things that revolve around is that. And the circus is a place where, right, is related to popular aesthetics, to poorness, to cheapness. Stupidity, street, and sort of all these aesthetics and ideologies really spoke to me. And also the street, I learned a lot of like juggling and tissue literally in the trees and on the street and being with people. So it was like community building, counterculture.
Are you there, Paula? Oh, yeah, you froze for us.
Can you hear?
Yeah. No, you stopped at counterculture, but I think we definitely got the gist of that. So what are you working on now? Have you got any future project? What's the main thing that's taking up a lot of your time that you're working on at the moment?
Ooh, exciting. I'm part of a climate justice code that we're making with Casco. We are doing I'm part of a committee that is working on repair, reparations, rematriation, and sort of like wanting to ask our institutions, how can your politics are aligned with climate justice? And by climate justice, we mean social justice too, of course. So yeah, that's one project. And then the other project that I'm starting is a piece. It's a little bit a baby being incubated about the implication of it's an autobiographical work of the implication of my families in the militias of the 70s in Colombia.
Brilliant. Felix, do you want to just come off mute and ask your question?
Oh, if you insist.
Good to hear your voice as always.
Of course. Hi, thanks for the chat. My question was regarding how has political correctness influenced the norm or trend development or evolution? So, you know, with our very hyper politically correct society development, there's been benefits and perhaps negatives. Like, how have you experienced or seen it influence the, the movement of circus? Does the question make sense?
It makes sense. I think I'm gonna answer it from a lens of performance and also activism, I would say. Yeah. Definitely, thanks for the question. It's brilliant, yeah. It's it has affected me in the sense that I, you know, political correctness comes from a certain culture. It's US culture. So it was important within that context, but it's a politics that got exported as many imperialist beliefs without being actualized.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of experiences, for example, here in the this is also a bit of an unpopular opinion, but in the North Love, I, for example, hear very little discussions about, so the understanding of race comes really about like skin color, which is something that has been experienced as apartheid in the North Love, but doesn't talk about like it has the danger of homogenizing. So we talk about, which is super important, for example, the Black Lives Matter movement is super important, when there were Africans sinking in the Mediterranean, this question of whose life is valued and who doesn't, and also same with Latinidad, like the Latinidad or the Chicano, or like the lenses that I have, like in order to study, or that people have reference to look at me, are based on like Chicano and Latinx culture. That is a culture that is a second generation culture in the US.
Yeah.
Very different to the place where I come from, because I grew up in Colombia, my family is there. And third, and like most importantly, that this is kind of the unpopular a bit opinion, is that there is no enough for me a reflection about anti-war, anti-deportation, and imperialist logics that are at place, like this geopolitical and political economy. Like, why are we so well in the North Love? Why can we have all this privilege? There is no enough reflection for me.
Interesting. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Felix. Has anyone got any other questions at all? No. If not, Paula, where can people support you? Like, if you've got any social media handles, or where can people continue to see the work that you're doing?
You can look at my website. It's, I think, also it's in the University of the Underground, but it's paulachaves.net. I have Facebook, I have Instagram, and you can contact me through the University of the Underground. They have my contact.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for that enriching and talk, Paula. And wish you all nothing but success. And we look forward to seeing what you do next. And thanks everybody for joining us today. And have a wonderful rest of your day.
Thank you
very much for the invitation.